Say What radio show. With no agenda. It's always a surprise. But if we're not having fun, we're doing something wrong. Saturdays, 6 to 8 p.m. Eastern, 3 to 5 Pacific. On Haggy Shack Radio at HaggyShack.com. Say what? And we are live.
Hello, everybody out there in listening land. This is Nancy Hopkins. You're listening to the Say What radio show, and Colleen Kelly is my co-host and producer, Haggy Shack Radio producing. It's being simulcast over Wolf Spirit Radio, and we've got with us Emily Norcross, who was our third Saturday of the month co-host, and we have Janet Moore with us, who is Jan Moore to me. And she's from Great Britain, and she always brings a different view, let's say, of discussions. And so I am so grateful that you are here, Jan. And how are you doing today?
Well, thank you. And what a lovely thing to say. I'm doing great, actually. Although I'm a Brit, I'm now living in Colorado, just outside Durango. And winter has arrived. We've had a couple of really low overnight temperatures and our first snow flurry the other day as well. So it's bring out the winter woolies and the long johns ready for the snow to hit us.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Now, Emily's in, where are you, in New Jersey or Pennsylvania?
New Jersey, yeah.
New Jersey.
Well, I think you could classify it as Pennsylvania. I'm like right there.
Yeah, right. And how's the weather there? Because
It was really warm today. It was 75 degrees. I had to actually go and hose my horses off because they were sweating. And I don't necessarily like to do it because it drops down really cold at night. But, I mean, it was unrelenting on them today.
Well, be prepared because I talked to Walt, what was it, day before yesterday? And he was like, yeah, it's like 70 degrees. And then last night they had a storm.
Yeah.
And it's down in the 30s. So I don't know if it's coming your way or what, but well, maybe.
Yeah, it's looking like it is. It's looking like it's dropping down into the 30s, even into the 20s at night. I mean, I'm lucky. My horses are in a really warm barn, and they don't necessarily need blankets during the day because it's still too warm for them. But this weather is ridiculous, you know, and my dogs are feeling it. My cats are feeling it, and, you know, my girlfriend went out for a trail ride today, and, you know, she called me. She's like, I wore too many layers. I'm sweating. This was such a bad option for today. It was, everyone's feeling it, and I think we're going to get hit with a really, really rough winter.
Well, let's hope not.
Winter's, I hope not, too.
I was up in Binghamton, New York last weekend, this time, and it was 32 degrees. But it wasn't the 32 degrees that is a dry 32 degrees. It seems damp, even.
It's and very damp.
Yeah, it was very annoying. But I absolutely know why I don't live there.
Yeah. Yep.
Well, now, trust a Brit to get everybody talking about the weather, eh?
Well, one of the reasons I wanted you guys to meet is because you both have had horses. And, you know, you've got that commonality of just being with animals of that size. Most of us, dogs, cats, you know, littler things than that. But it has to be just an amazing interaction with an animal that is, A, that big, and, B, take so much care. I mean, I have so much honor for you guys that can do that. So, I don't know, Em, you're the co-host here. You want to talk to Jan about that, or, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. First of all, I would absolutely say I did Facebook stalk you after you friend requested me, and I saw that you were riding a beautiful chestnut Arabian who looked absolutely darling. So cute. You know, I just, what do you find, it's different for each equestrian, what do you find the most fascinating about the animals that you get in contact with when you go to the farm?
Well, you've opened up a can of worms here, Emily, because it's a really, you know, my story with with horses has been absolutely phenomenal. The horse that you saw was actually one of the horses on an Arabian horse ranch that my husband Bill and I were running for about 4 years in Austin up until last April. That's April 2015. Mm-hmm. And I've had a passion for horses all my life. And it's really about being with these amazing creatures. I find them so beautiful. I've always been drawn to the hot bloods. I even remember back to when I was probably about 13, and I'm now chronologically 61, although I've been taking a year off since I was 50, so I'm actually 39. But I remember that horse. I think I remember her to the day I died. Her name was Natasha, and she was a lovely bay Arabian. Mm. And in England, I think they must have different strains, because the Arabians are much smaller than the ones that we had at the ranch in Austin. And I remember that she was a typical Arabian, quite hot, ran off with me, and it was love at first ride, you know. Mm. But so I think for me, it's making that spiritual connection that really counts. And it was only when I got my Andalusian in 2004, I think it was, in England. He absolutely changed my life, because he was my dream horse, and he was actually delivered to me. It was manifested and definitely sent from heaven, because he absolutely transformed my whole approach to horses from very much a conventional British Horse Society pony club type philosophy or approach to a much more natural horsemanship approach. But the reason for that change was because he had a complete emotional breakdown about a year, well, all leading up to the first year that I had him, and I had to get a horse whisperer out to help me, because he was becoming so dangerous. He was really scaring the life out of me, and I've always been very, very confident as a rider and with around horses. And the horse whisperer actually worked for one of the UK's horse rescue organisations, and what they used to do was send him out at very low cost to people that were having difficulty. Their idea was, if we can prevent things getting worse and prevent the horse ending up either slaughtered, you know, put down, or in a rescue, then it's obviously more beneficial than letting things get out of hand. So he spent a day with me with his partner, and told me at the end of the day that my horse was so dangerous, he would either kill me, kill himself, or kill both of us, because he was absolutely wound to the top. And at the time, and I was told that, you know, the options were sell him, which was not an option with his current mental state, to have him put down, or to go back to square one and completely rehabilitate him. And, you know, this horse, he was so beautiful. He was my absolute dream horse, and he was the most affectionate horse you could wish to have. So, of course, there's no way I could have had him put down. It was just impossible. And although I was at the time running a multi-million pound IT project for a major retailer in the UK and commuting an hour and a half each way, I opted to do what was the third option of rehabilitating him and start from scratch. And the instruction was, you've got to work with him on the ground every day. Mm-hmm. And it took me probably 2.5 years to turn him round. But in that 2.5 years, I learned everything I could about equine psychology and behaviour. Mm-hmm. I read a lot on natural horsemanship. But I also was led down a spiritual journey. And it was through my research into how to deal with all these real severe behavioral problems with him that I was led to a book called The Tao of Equus by Linda Cohenoff. And this book is subtitled Emotional Healing Through the Horse, or words to that effect anyway, Emotional Healing of a Woman. And it was really about Linda's experience having had a quite abusive marriage, and how she also had an Arabian horse. And it was her experiences, and it was a very metaphysical book. It was talking about reincarnation and about her spirit ancestors being the horse. So this kind of opened up a completely new vista for me in terms of much more of a spiritual exploration. And I just felt, I remember an episode sitting in the living room at home with my previous husband, feeling this absolutely unavoidable compulsion to research into reincarnation. And it was through doing that that I discovered the secret and this whole philosophy of manifestation and self-determination and everything else, and it really just shifted my whole life onto a completely different path. So as a result, every time I meet a horse, it's like really connecting on a deep level, just to kind of touch spirits, if that makes sense.
No, it does. And you know, I've had the pleasure of working on an Arabian horse rescue farm. And I actually own a Hanoverian Arab cross, and I've seen, I mean, working with them, you know, it is a very daunting task for a lot of people, we'll say. And I've seen a lot of people be so headstrong and so forward into getting to know horses, and when they realize the amount of work that's involved, they kind of back down, and that upsets me, because these animals are incredibly magical. You know, my gelding, you know, he picked me out of a field. I had never met the horse before in my entire life. I was walking past him to see my parents' horse Pizza, and, you know, he just came to the gate and whinnied at me and kept, you know, knocking at the gate asking me to come over there, and I finally ended up going there, and 2 years later, he ends up in my pasture, you know, as my horse. So, you know, you're absolutely right in saying that horses pick you. And they're not necessarily supposed to be easy. They're supposed to teach us something. And when you grasp the when you grasp the lesson they're trying to teach you with my baby, has been unbelievably hard. But, you know, it's this very rewarding journey, and to get that, and I'm so glad that you said that you agree, and you didn't want to sell your horse, you didn't want to give him up because everyone said he was bad. Any horse I've ever ridden, people have told me, no, he's crazy, he needs to be glue, and I just refused. And the fact you stayed with him, I give you massive props for that. You know, there's a lot of people that don't have that willpower or the love for the animals.
No, that's true. And I've actually had this. The first horse I actually owned, I was 29. And, you know, my mum always was completely puzzled by my obsession with horses, because we weren't a horsey family at all. I mean, we did have, I think, some farming genes in the background there, but certainly nothing relating to horses. And I mean, I was just so obsessed. But every horse that I was drawn to was a hot blood. It was either an Arabian, or my first horse was an Anglo-Arab. And I actually then, after I'd had my daughters, I took on loan a thoroughbred cross who had absolute confidence issues. And I remember being at this, it was at the boarding stable, and somebody said to me, why on earth are you bothering with that horse? Why don't you get one that you can do something with? And I thought, actually, I really get so much satisfaction from dealing with you know, the horse's issues. And it was only much, much later when I discovered my purpose that I realized that the purpose of my connection with horses was absolutely linked to my life purpose, which is an empowerment coach and trainer. And what the horses were teaching me was about energy and about manifestation and about fear and how to deal with fear, because when you're working with a horse who is afraid of everything, which I know they're prey animals, so they all have some degree of fear issues, but when you've got that in extreme form in some horses, then it's literally a matter of life and death for you not to allow yourself to respond to that fear with fear yourself, to not allow your thoughts to go into fear, and also not to allow your energy to become tense and fearful. And what they taught me, and this was even before my Andalusian, the thoroughbred cross that I rode, was in a stable where we had to ride across this motorway bridge. And of course you've got all this traffic going underneath, and I've got this and I'm riding a nervous horse and desperately trying not to think about this horse reacting and me going over the edge of the bridge, you know. So it was really about, no, I'm going to be calm, I'm going to look to the end of the bridge, I'm going to visualize getting there, I'm going to just relax consciously. And you know, that they have been complete mentors, teachers and everything about so much of the metaphysical in terms of how I've had to behave and in their presence, and also learning a degree of animal communication with them as well. I've had some episodes where I've really got some incredible communication from the horses that I've worked with, who were really telling me the story of how they got to be the way they were. And certainly the 8 Arabians I was taking care of at the ranch in Austin had various degrees of post-traumatic stress because of how they'd been handled and related to on a place that was certainly a very, very wealthy environment with a huge amount of ignorance in terms of the nature of horses. And, you know, the response of some of these horses to a very heavy, dark environment that they were in was really tragic, you know. It was, and I'm just grateful that I was able to bring some love and light into that environment before I had to leave.
You know, it's funny because I knew when I was working at the Arabian Rescue, the horses that would come in, you could see the want for emotion in their eyes. And a lot of people don't understand how to handle an Arabian or a hot-blooded animal like a Morgan or a saddlebred, because they tend to need your full attention. And I'm not saying like, oh, okay, well, I'm watching the horse. And I think this is what I like most about horses. I don't know how to relieve my stress other than being with my horses. Right now, I'm battling a humongous confident issue with my guys. But when I go and I at least groom them and you know, spend some time with them, I take everything out of my brain and I focus on this animal. And to see people who walk into a barn, just grab the lead line, throw it on the halter, and just walk in front of the horse and not pay attention to what is going on with this animal, it kind of takes me back. And I was the assistant barn manager for this place, and I would tell people, please do not walk in front of the horse like that. I don't want anything happening where the horse lunges forward because you're not paying attention, you're on your phone, or you're talking to somebody else. You know, they're giving you cues on a very regular basis. And when they say something hurts, they might say something hurts by lunging forward and trampling you in the process. Or they might stop, and then you're pulling on them. Come on, buddy, what are you doing? Hurry up, we got to get out of the aisle way. So I think that when people come into the horse world, there's one of two ways that they can go. I get along with the people who go the real spiritual route with their animals. The people who come and spend time and really learn about their horses and really learn about how they react with their horses. Because it's not just about them. We have to do a lot of changing for them as well, because not every horse is the same. You know, I know it's such a cliche to say, you know, they're individual snowflake, but they really are. You know, I've never come across any other horse like my horse Dakota. I've never come across any other horse like my horse Phoenix. I've never come across a horse like Pizza. You know, every horse has their individual story. And when you spend the time with them and you interact with them on a daily basis and you know where they like their scratches, or you know where, you know, they like to go to the bathroom in their stall, these are things that connects you on a further, more spiritual level. And I may not be an animal communicator. I'm actually working with Jean Rockefeller, who is a very popular person on this station. She's helping me with
the foster. Yes, I know Jean. Yeah, I've had a reading with Jean, and it was actually through Jean. I think, like many people, I actually met Nancy because I'd seen the link off her site. And as soon as I saw a post by Jean about Jack the Watcher, that was it. She had me hooked.
Right? My mom told me, I didn't even know about it. My mom called me one day. She's like, you need to go find Jack the Watcher on Facebook. You need this. And, you know, I fell in love. And Jean's wonderful. You know, she's helping me with a foster dog who turns out, she said, is a lab dog. And he had tests and everything performed. It's really bad. But, you know, I wish I had her skills, because I would love to know what my horses are thinking. I'm pretty sure, though, they're cursing me out on a regular basis. Just saying. But it's a lot to do with learning them. And the people who just come into the horse world, have somebody else tack up their horse, they get on and ride, they jump a few fences, and that's it. That's not me. You know, I've never been like that. The horses are the reason that I'm alive today. You know, they turned my life around. They gave me a reason to live. They gave me hope. And, you know, people joke with me. They're like, oh, well, you can control a 1,500-pound animal with your legs. You must be pretty tough. Not necessarily. You just have to be able to know what they're thinking. And there are times I get on my horses and I'm like, oh, well, you know, I'm going to convince you it's your idea, so we're doing it. So whether you like it or not, you know. Excuse me. So
I think people have the misconception because of the size. They think that you have to use force, and that is absolutely opposite, because the horse reflects what you put into it. So, I mean, with me, what I would teach people is you need to work on the lightest touch. You know, some people, if they want to move the horse over, they'll absolutely heave against their side and push them over with brute force. And what I was teaching is just use a fingertip touch and gesture, and this just seem to pick it up. And if it's, if they don't pick it up straight away, just try a little harder, push it a little bit harder, and as soon as they respond, release it. And the thing is, people don't understand enough about how a horse operates, and then they're just setting themselves up for disaster because they end up rewarding the wrong behavior.
And it becomes dangerous. It becomes dangerous at that point. For you, the horse, and anybody who's in the vicinity of this animal.
Absolutely.
And I think that's what a lot of people lose sight of, is they're animals. They're wild at heart. You know, they could see a plastic bag and everyone, you know, there's memes all over the internet, you know, oh, my horse spooked a plastic bag again. I mean, these are legitimate things that if you don't take the time to show them it's not dangerous, they will put you in danger. And it's not because they want to. That's their instinct. They think something is coming to kill them. You know, I was riding a horse one day who was terrified of puddles. I swear, she stopped in front of the puddle and is looking at it and said, oh, my God, there's a shark in there. We're not going over this. There's a shark in there. I know there is. And I could feel the whole conversation through this horse with what she was going through. And it took a few tries to get her through the puddle, and eventually, very hesitantly, she did. But, you know, when I started riding, I was told to use brute force. Like, if a horse wasn't doing what you wanted, you hit him with a crop. I am not about that. I refuse to hit any of my animals with any kind of whips. My two geldings, they get lunge lined. They use what's called the Pessoa rig. It's or you might know it as a bitting rig. So it like moves their muscles without being on them, and it trains their body to correctly muscle itself. And I just have to put them on the lunge line. I don't need a lunging whip. I don't need any kind of commands other than a click, a kiss, and a move forward. And that are the commands. I'm very lucky in that aspect. But there are people, again, who don't take the time to learn their horse's cues. I think that's something a lot of people are missing.
Completely. And, you know, I've seen some terrible things. I mean, going back to the puddle thing, I mean, one of the things my Andalusian was afraid of was water. And, in fact, you know, for me, dealing with his issues was very much a shift off from this, you're the boss, you know, the horse ought to do what you're asking it to. And a lot of the issues that he had were due to the way that he was brought up. He was raised. And I won't kind of go into all of that because we haven't got all day. But also,
we can discuss that later.
You know, I got him when he was coming up to 5 years old, so still very young. And he, as I was asking him to do things, it became too much for him. It just blew his mind, literally. But I was expecting probably more of him than he was able to cope with, unknowingly at the time. And I would actually be really, you know, putting a lot of pressure on him to go through water. And that was when he started rearing and all sorts of things. And this is where I got to the point of asking for help. But, you know, once I understood the issues and learned all sorts of different approaches to help him deal with that, we had where I was riding in England, we had a trail with a ford, a stream across a creek in American, across the trail. And this is what he was absolutely terrified of. So one day I rode him down there, and then I got off, and I literally went into the ford and played with him in the ford until he got comfortable with being in there, and the problem was solved. So you're absolutely right, by getting them attuned to these things that they are instinctively afraid of in some cases, by you know, the whole process that I went through with him was in effect training him to use his left brain, training him to reason instead of react out of right brain, you know, prey, fight or flight kind of thing. It was teaching him to actually pause and think about things. And I know when I was doing some jumping with him, which wasn't a huge amount because I was really more focused on dressage with him, being, you know, typically talented as an Andalusian in that respect, you could even feel him thinking things through as he approached the fence. You know, instead of kind of shutting his eyes and jumping, he'd actually be weighing it up and working out his pace and everything else. And I remember one time I was riding on the road, which of course we always had to do a lot of in England, and this was, you know, after maybe 5 or 6 years of having him, where he'd really got over his major issues. He was always pretty volatile, and had me on the floor quite a few times. But we were riding along this road, and they were doing roadworks. They'd actually closed the road because they dug a channel in the road and put these metal plates across them. And I rode up to the plate just to see how he would react to it. And literally he was looking at it thinking, yeah, I'll go over it. And I actually turned him away because I didn't want him to slip on the metal and scare himself. But he got to the point of really being willing to do whatever I asked of him. You know,
Jan, the idea that he had to learn to reason, was that because of his age? You said he was young.
No, it was just, you know, most horses instinctively are fight or flight. You know, they are prey animals, so they react to things. So this is where, especially very sensitive horses, which are more of, as we say, the hot bloods, you could call them more spirited, that's one of the terms in the horse world, they tend to be more sensitive and more reactive to things than kind of a draft horse or a heavier horse, or even, a lot of the warm bloods are a lot more easygoing than the Arabians and the Thoroughbreds and and so on. So you're actually educating them to really, rather than react and run away, to really take in what it is they're seeing, to actually work out how to deal with it. Because also the vision is very different from ours, and the senses are very different from ours as well. So you're dealing with a whole different physiology as well as a psychology. So by actually giving them experiences where they're learning about different objects, different obstacles, different situations, they are learning to respond differently rather than just being reactive. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does. They're basically, well, they're like children, and if you don't give the children the opportunity to learn, then they actually just maintain that flight or fight posture.
That is absolutely
huh?
And one of the issues with him was that he was weaned at 6 months, and I don't agree at all with conventional weaning. It's like enforced separation in rather than a more natural moving away from that very strong bond with the mother, with the dam, and completely removed from his home environment to the owner who was actually one of my daughter's friend's mother, who, let's say there's a lot of ego in the equestrian world.
Oh, that's an understatement of history.
Unfortunately, there are people who kind of their ego takes over, and they like to think they know everything about everything. And this woman was one of those. She was very big in the local dressage community, and she bought this horse, my Andalusian, as a foal to raise him.
Jan, can I just stop you? In case people don't know what dressage is, it's a timed test where you're in what's called a dressage ring, and there are different movements that are accompanied by the different signs that are around the ring. The signs are indicated by letters. So you're timed, you're scored on your perfection of what your test is, and the tests are usually posted beforehand, and you learn your test, you go in, and you perform the best you can, and then they give you a score.
Yes, and just to expand on that, I mean, classical dressage is literally just a word for training. You're progressively training the horse into more complex movements, and also training in a way that is it's not just about training movement, it's actually about developing the physiology of the horse to strengthen it to be able to perform classical movements. I mean, the peak of that is the Spanish Riding School with the Lipizzaners, or Grand Prix dressage competitions. But it's an absolute, to me, I was never very interested in dressage growing up, but when I got my Andalusian, it's like, well, this horse is born for this kind of work, because the movements of an Andalusian, honestly, they're to die for. They are just so incredible. And the joy of getting horses to respond with the kind of power that is possible, but channeled power and grace and beauty is just beyond joy, really. You know, and anyway, that's kind of digressing a bit, but thank you for clarifying that. What I was I've forgotten what I was saying now.
Yes, the story.
Sorry, I'm back. So the issue with the way that he was raised was that this woman had the view that she ought to keep all her horses separately because she was so frightened of them injuring themselves by, you know, rough play together. So what happened was that he didn't get the support of the herd. In a natural environment, you know, a foal is brought up by not just the mother, but, you know, the other mares and the other horses in the herd, and even in domesticated circumstances, even other geldings and things. So, and that is what creates the confidence in the horse, because it's kind of like, you know, the difference between an orphan and a kid that grows up with really loving parents that will support them as they're growing up and will make them feel confident in themselves, believe in themselves.
Well, when they say, you know, it takes a village to raise a child, I mean, that's essentially what it is to raise a foal.
Yeah, completely. So he hadn't had this, and unfortunately the ignorance of the and I mean that in real terms, in terms of she didn't understand how to acclimatize a young horse in a way that wouldn't frighten him. She had him in circumstances like, oh, well, if I go and stand next to a really busy road with him, he'll get used to traffic. Well, it frightened the life out of him. Apparently that's when he started rearing, because he was so overwhelmed by suddenly being faced with all this heavy traffic. He just couldn't cope with it. And, you know, there was a whole series of events that really all together contributed to what in effect was an equine nervous breakdown. So I also had an animal communicator out to, this was towards the end of the rehabilitation period, who really confirmed all that I'd worked out in terms of not only the things I've mentioned, but also the way that he was broken in. It was far too early, I think less than 3 years old. And I know over here in the US, horses are broken so much earlier than they are in the UK. Typically it's 4 or 5 over there. And the Andalusian breed, like the Lipsana and some of the other hot bloods, are not emotionally mature enough to deal with that. They're late developers. And in fact, the Spanish riding school don't actually do ridden work until I think they're about 8 years old. They do all the in-hand work first. So he was also broken by a kind of hunter-type horse trainer. So, you know, no sensitivity whatsoever. And, you know, the horse, the animal communicator said that his story was, how could I trust anyone that just shouted all the time, you know? It was really incredible to get the horse's view of what is a typical approach to backing a young horse.
And I have to agree with you 100% on this. My Arabian Hanoverian, he's 7 years old. He's coming 7 this year. He's rehabbing from a torn suspensory in his front leg. And at the barn I was at previously, she's like, no, you have to get on him now. That's the only way you're going to be able to walk him every day. No. He's not ready physically and mentally, because he was a rescue. He was from a breeder in New York State who passed away from cancer. The kids had no idea the mom was sick. So then they come to the farm to realize that she had, like, 30 horses that were literally starving to death. And they had no idea how to care for these animals. The girl who I'm talking about has my horse's half-brother. He was kept as a stallion in a round pen for 7 years of his life. No idea about the outside world. No idea about any... I mean, they very rarely handled him. And he turned into an 18-hand, 1,800-pound monster. Towards the end of my career there, I told him, I'm not walking this horse anymore. He's dangerous. Nobody taught him how to use his brain. He just is in a flight or flight mode all the time, and the problem is he's 1,800 pounds. You can't push an 1,800-pound horse off your lap.
Nice.
And I've been lucky with Phoenix because he's got the Arab headset. He's got the Arab brain. He's got kind of the Hanoverian body. So he's weird looking. I swear, I look at him and I'm like, who put you together? Like, this is, the confirmation's awful. But with him, it just takes just a couple minutes for him to realize what's going on. And it's as simple as him understanding. You know, I had to put him on a trailer for the third time in his life. And he just looked at it, said, there's a bag of hay, I'm going in. And he just walked right in. You know, for a coming seven-year-old who's never really been handled, he was just gelded last January. He's had awful handling through his life until I got him in March. And I'm like you. I didn't get my own first horse until I was 29. And he really has taught me. He does not like women. And we struggle with that on a very regular basis. So it's hard for him to kind of rely on me. He wants to. He really wants to. But he still has that inclination in the back of his head kind of saying, hey, you know, I'm not really sure about you. Ladies have not really treated me well. Never have I raised a hand to him. Never have I given him any reason to be upset with me. It's just programmed in him on right now. And, you know, my barn manager and I were talking, and I love my barn manager. He's 75 years old, and he's still doing this. Cleaning stalls every day, bringing horses in and out. Man is wonderful. And he's like, oh, you know, maybe I should back your horse. I'm thinking, you're 75. You're not backing my baby. Like, I know he's not going to do something stupid, but in the off chance he decides to be stupid, I don't want you getting hurt. I'm younger. I don't bounce as well as I used to, but I still bounce. So if there was a reason for him to do anything, I'd rather it be with me. Hence why we're doing all of the rig work, and we're working on kind of, I hate Pat Pirelli and that kind of whole gig, but I try to work on, you know, confidence building with him and relationship building with him. And he has come a long way. And it's going to take time. If I don't back him until he's 9, yeah, it's late for him, and he could be doing so much more, but he's not mentally ready. He still thinks he's a baby, too. Mm. He still thinks he's bucking around. He's having a good time. You know, and I just got him with no heat in his joint from the tear. So I don't want to push him. And there are a lot of people out there. It's a business for them. And I understand that you have to make money and you need quick turnaround. But when you break a horse at a certain age like that, like young, there's a lot of battles. And there's battles with breaking a horse at an older age, too, because they tend to have opinions. And those opinions are very hard to break unless you know how to work with that horse. So I agree. The United States, we break them way too early, especially the quarter horses. I see quarter horses ending their show careers at 11 or 12 because of the training that's been put into them. It's been awful training.
Yeah, and there was also a really good article that I read on the fact that their skeleton isn't mature enough to take the weight. It's still developing and growing, and it's still soft because it's, you know, still in the development stage. And so, it, you know, by breaking them too early, it can cause horrendous physical issues. I mean, one of the things that's often done in the UK is they'll break a horse or back a horse. I much prefer back a horse to breaking it because, you know, what does that imply? It's like breaking their spirit, and that's not what it's about at all. But they'll back a horse and then they'll turn it away. In other words, they'll put it back out to grazing, let it kind of process the experience it's been through, and then bring it back into work a year later or something. And, you know, that to me is a much more long-term solution than the kind of I need it, I want it now. You know, this instant gratification, I want to be on it as soon as possible. And just, it's, you know, you wouldn't subject a young child to the pressures of
adulthood.
Exams and things too early, you know?
Essentially adulthood.
Exactly. And it's interesting because I also had an ex-racehorse. In fact, we've had a couple of them. I bought, they were mainly for my daughter. And the second one was, we'd only had him 3 months and she decided to give up and run off with her boyfriend. There's a whole other story which we won't go into now. But it was actually interesting because I was in two minds whether to sell him or whether to keep him, as so that my Andalusian had a companion, because I had my horses at home and I don't believe in keeping a horse alone because it's a herd animal. And it was then that I had the animal communicator out to just to learn from both of them. You know, I wanted to really validate what I believed was the issue that, or the issues that caused my Andalusian's problems. But she also communicated with my ex-racehorse thoroughbred called Bertie, who was, honestly, I have never come across a horse like him. He was like a horse with a human soul. Honestly, it's very difficult to describe.
Nope, I completely understand it.
Good. It was just like this, it has obviously very old soul and a knowingness, and he was actually an incredible comfort to me through all the trauma of my daughter and what happened with her. And when the communicator came along to communicate with them, his question was, am I staying? Which just about floored me. It's like, oh my God, I can't sell him now, can I? You know, because he'd had this experience of being passed around from pillar to post. He'd raced till he was 7 because he was pretty successful to begin with. He won races, but then obviously just didn't like the life and didn't do as well. But he actually raced on the flat for years, which is quite unusual because they get to a certain age and they put them over hurdles and things, but he stayed on the flat. And then when he came out of racing, he was literally in two homes within less than a year before we got him. And he was actually, he didn't like men. And again, his experience with men was heavy-handed, it was loud, it was domineering, and his message was, I don't want to be treated like a machine anymore. And I think this is not just in racing, this is across the equestrian community, that so many horse owners treat them like they're a bike or a car, that they can bring them out, put them in gear, they'll do what they want, they'll put them back in the stall, and that's the end of the relationship. There is no relationship. It's just, they might as well ride a bike, you know?
Oh, no. I don't think, okay, hold on, let me get my thought here. I was able to talk with Lady Martha Sitwell. She's a very well-known fox hunter over in England. And she's very daring, very, very daring, doing six-foot jumps in side saddle. I mean, these are things I would never dream of doing.
No, me neither.
And I asked her, I said, what, you know, you just get on a horse, any horse. I mean, they just draw horses out of the bucket, and they just get on and go. I said, what, you know, when you get a horse that you've never ridden before, how do you get yourself over the jump? She's like, I trust the horse. I just flat out trust my horse. She said, because first of all, he wouldn't be there if he wasn't good at fox hunting. And two, she said, if I'm going to have any kind of an issue going over that jump, he's going to pick up on it instantaneously, and he's going to dump me. And I have no way of staying on if he fakes off to the right. Yeah, she's right, you know, or excuse me, fakes to the left. So I was giving lessons this summer, and the girl was very new. I put her on Dakota, who was very, you know, relaxed, chilled out, not really hot and bothered. And, you know, she wanted to learn how to barrel race. I said, well, you know, I'm not going to throw you on my horse and put you around barrels because you have no idea how to sit a horse. You've got to learn the basics. And the basics are what's going to help you get through the levels of what you need to learn from a horse before you can get on, run a set of barrels, and then put them away. And she was really gung-ho. She was really excited. And I was starting to get her to do some half-seat or two-point, you might know it, and just getting her to kind of balance on him. And every time she fell, she would rip his reins, and his mouth would just jerk back. I had to stop her. I seriously almost ripped her off of my horse for that. And I said, just because you lose your balance does not mean you take it out on this animal. He's doing what he's supposed to be doing. There is no, if he was doing something wrong, I would have pulled you off. I would have gotten on him, and I would have corrected the issue. But if you're constantly pulling on their mouth and kicking them forward at the same time and yelling at them and screaming at them, it's not accomplishing anything. You know, and I would allow her just a free ride if I was on the farm and she just wanted to ride. One day she had her reins all the way up by her ears. And I walked into the ring. I said, what are you doing? Why are the reins so incredibly high? What's going on? She's like, well, he's just not paying attention, and I need him to back up. Well, you don't really tell him to back up that way, so I had to kind of tell her that, you know, until you're a little bit more schooled, let's kind of, you know, focus on going forward. Going back is not something you need right now, especially if you're going to run barrels. And to hear her screaming at him, there is nothing accomplished. You're terrifying your horse. You are putting yourself and the horse in a position where they're not going to want to work. They're just going to lock their knees like a donkey and be like, nope, I'm done. And
well, all the other response is to run away, to be running and running. Interesting. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you, Hen. Carry on.
No, it's just, every time I go to a farm, even where my parents' horse Pizza is, there's a girl who gets on her horse and she just yells and screams at her, that's not the lead I asked for. Sure is. You know, you gave incorrect cues. The first time I put my husband on Dakota, I turned my back for a second, and I shouldn't have because I was chit-chatting with one of the barn girls. And all of a sudden, I hear my husband going, whoa, Dakota, whoa, and I hear him bouncing. And I look at him. I said, what did you do? He said, I didn't do anything. Dakota just started trotting. I said, Dakota doesn't just start trotting on his own. He's a lazy horse. You have to, like, kick him to get him to move. And he's finally like, yeah, I might have kicked him a little bit. Yeah, you did, because if you didn't ask, he wouldn't have done it. Human souls are in them. I know Dakota is from a past life of mine. He wouldn't have picked me. And I was just looking at him, and I just looked into his soul, really, and saw this need to be with me. Come to find out, he's 11 years old. He's had 11 owners.
Wow.
Why? For what reason? He's a fantastic horse. They did a lot of bad training on him, but he's so incredibly willing. And for somebody to give up a horse like that, that hurts me. Because there are so many horses, and I see it all the time on these rescue pages or these auction pages, these horses that need home or these well-behaved, well-trained horses are being sent to auction because somebody bought a horse without doing the proper research, kids fell out of love with it, and then, you know, they were passed on.
Or they were just unsuitable for that person. I mean,
right.
I know the place that I, when I had my horses at home, it was in a village in England, and across the road, I mean, this is this is one of the stories about how I manifested my horse. I just kind of set this intention. I really wanted an Andalusian, and I still can't remember to this day what prompted that. Obviously, it must have been some divine guidance. And when we first moved into this cottage with about 3 acres, we had the grazing, but no stabling, and we had an old barn that we eventually renovated, and across the road was the boarding stable. So I used to stable my horses across there. I still had this thoroughbred cross at the time, and a pony for my daughters. And then one day, it was when I was in my corporate job, taking a few days off over Easter, I thought, I'll just have a look in Horse and Hound, which is the kind of go-to magazine in the UK for if you want to look for a horse for sale. I mean, it's very much aimed at, you know, hunting more than anything, but other competitive disciplines. But if you were looking to buy a horse, it was like half the magazine was horses for sale. So I was browsing through this and came across this ad for an Andalusian with a local number. And I thought, I'll just ring up because I'll go and have a look at this horse while I'm taking a few days off. So I phoned this number and started talking to this lady, and I realized after a few minutes that it was the owner of the boarding stable across the road where my horses were stabled. And I'd seen this grey horse that they'd been riding. It was in a stable opposite to where mine was stable. I'd seen him being ridden up, you know, up and out on the road and everything. And hadn't really clicked that this was an Andalusian. So anyway, I tried the horse, fell in love with him, and that was it. It was kind of, the deal was done, as it were. My fate was sealed. But, you know, one of the people that I started to ride out with was a woman who hadn't had a lot of experience with horses. And she'd bought this horse that I think, if not pure thoroughbred, had a lot of thoroughbred in her. And she was just frightened to death of her. So she'd ridden her out, and this horse just took off with her. I don't think she bolted so much as was just, you know, going much faster than the lady thought was she could cope with, and ended up selling her and getting a different horse, an Irish draft, I think it was. Who was a very different kettle of fish completely, and okay. But, you know, you see people getting, they like the look of a horse, especially a flashy horse, and they get the horse, and it's just like putting a beginner driver in a Ferrari. It's a disaster waiting to happen because, you know, they just don't have the experience to deal with that level of horse, you know. But some people think a horse is a horse is a horse, and there's no difference. Well, there's a huge difference. So,
Jan, I'm going to interrupt you here because we're going to take a break. And when we come back, I want to take it into a different kind of way, because as I'm listening to you guys talk about it, I'm continually seeing what you're saying to be about a horse is also true about people. And,
absolutely.
You know, so yeah. I want to kind of go there. So what do you learn? Mm-hmm. What are people? Because, well, anyway, we're taking a break, ladies and gentlemen out there, and we will be back in how many minutes, Colleen, about?
6 minutes.
There you go. So we'll be right back. Thank you.
All righty, and we are back.
Okie dokie. Thank you very much, Colleen. Today is November 19th, 2016. You are listening to the Say What Show. This is a production of Haggy Shack Radio, which you can find at HaggyShack.com. And then there's WolfSpiritRadio.com that's simulcasting this. On both websites, you can donate. On Wolf Spirit, you can become a member for $5 a month. That they check with you every month to see if you want to keep going. And you can get a hold of all the archives. You can also get the archives the week after a show goes live. You can download it or just listen to it again. And if you go over to Haggy Shack, that's HaggyShack.com, you can donate and you can get three S4 stickers from CosmicReality.net, which is my website store. And what else do I have to say there? No, I don't know. But I do want to say that I so appreciate you coming on, Jan and Emily, because so many of us don't have that experience. I rode for quite a number of years and have this affinity for horses, but wasn't brought up in any kind of an environment where I should have gotten that. And I do believe that that's part of the reincarnation concept. But because we all know Jack the Watcher and Gene, I have to tell you a story that will maybe give you an indication of the stories that horses hold, maybe, because I do, you know, they may come back. All I know is that Gene calls me up, or writes me, and she says, Jack says that, and anybody that's listened to me knows that I have a memory of being George Patton, General George Patton, in a reincarnation concept. And Gene says, Jack says that he knows George Patton, and from the Olympics. And at that moment, I thought I knew everything there was to know about Patton. I didn't actually research him. I just knew him because I knew him. And I'm going, the Olympics? George wasn't in the Olympics. What the heck are they talking about? And he says that George's horse didn't come over from America or something. She said, I don't know why his horse wasn't there, but George had to get another horse. And the Swiss Army military, whatever, said, with the horses, they said, well, you can have one of our horses. And so George was walking through the barn, and he walked right past Jack, and Jack reached out and bit him on the left shoulder, at which point George turned around and said, let me see this one. And they went and they did the Olympics, and Jack is mad at George. And, you know, I should have won that Olympics, Jack's saying. And Gene's saying, he's really mad at George. I'm going like, okay, why is he telling me this? I don't know if I can do anything about it.
Leave it to a horse to be mad lifetimes after.
Oh, yeah, lifetime later, yeah. So what happened was that when she said that the horse reached out and bit him on the left shoulder, it totally freaked me out, because when I was 10 years old, a horse came up behind me and bit me on my left shoulder and wow. Left a mark. You know, almost bleeding, not quite, you know, that mark thing.
Oh, yeah, the really black bruise that you get.
Yes, and I don't ever, you know, push aside a synchronicity like that. And so, but again, I don't have any memory of it. And so I said, okay, I'll try to make a connection here to George and figure out, you know, what happened. And Jack, again, he was really angry. It was like, you know, it was his fault that we lost the Olympics. And in fact, they came in second because of a fraction of a you know, like a second off or something. And so I did connect with George, and I said, George, what was Jack talking about? And he said, well, and the story is that at that time they didn't take the horses over to, you know, didn't put them on a ship and take them over. They actually got horses once they were at the Olympics. So it was nobody was riding their really own horse. I mean, unless you were European, but the Americans were not bringing their horses over. And this horse that he was riding was about to do a jump, and he made a move that was so drastic that George actually corrected, thinking the horse was stumbling. And he wasn't stumbling, he just could make that move that George was not aware of. And so they were a second late, and Jack was mad at him. But it turned out that Jack and I have been together on more than one occasion. There was a number of occasions, actually, where he was involved in my past lifetimes. So the fact that they're there, and we did confirm that, in fact, we've actually got pictures of Jack and George Patton jumping, you know, over during the Olympics. So,
awesome.
Yeah, it was a real story. But when you guys were talking, it was right now, like, we like to talk about current events and, you know, what's happening. And, of course, the big elephant in the room is the presidential election. After it, Jan actually called me to, you know, what are you thinking about it? Because who knew what to think, you know? What just happened? And what are your opinions now, Jan? How are you feeling about that? And I do have a reason. We're going to get back to the horse thing, but right now I just want to kind of get, you know, how you're feeling about it.
Yeah, it's very interesting because one of the reasons I called you was also because you posted that article by Starfire Tour about the timeline shifts. And I've been observing the election because, you know, I'm a Brit as a resident alien in the US. So I don't actually have a vote, but obviously anything that happens over here is gonna impact me. So I was very much uncomfortable with Trump. I was even more uncomfortable with Hillary, I have to say. And, you know, my view leading up to it was, you know, we've got, is it 300 million people here in the US? How have we ended up with these two candidates? It's just bizarre. But given that I teach neutrality, I was trying to practice my own teaching and really stay neutral and just kind of observe and suspend judgment to see how things are panning out. Because I have a very strong belief that whatever happens, there is a higher purpose to it. And as I was seeing the pre-election campaigning proceed, I was very aware of how it was generating a lot of division. And of course, post-election, the level of hysteria on social media has been phenomenal. And I read the Starfire Tour article, which, for anybody who hasn't read it, it's really about, and her article is based on scientific research that she's done into timeline shifts and timeline reboots. And the gist of the article was saying that there were two possible timelines. One was going to lead to nuclear disaster, and the other was not. And as she proceeded, there's a whole series of posts that lead to the conclusion that if Hillary had been elected as president, that would have led us to a nuclear disaster. And with Trump as leader, it would not. It would avert that nuclear disaster. And that was purely on the basis of security issues. And of course, we've seen all the issues around Hillary's use of a personal server and the WikiLeaks stuff and everything else, and the policy to have open borders and to allow immigrant in without due diligence and so on. So that was the basis of the difference in the timeline. And when I spoke to you, Nancy, which was the day after, I think, when you pointed out to me that Donald Trump looked different when he did his victory speech from how he'd looked during the campaign, I actually brought it up on the computer, and it was like, wow. And the timeline reboot that Starfire Tour was talking about was saying that leading up to the election, this is connected with the solar flares and the solar activity that creates these reboots. There are series leading up, in the days leading up to the election, and what was happening was they were trying to find the most evolved version of Donald Trump. And when you pointed out to me how he looked different, I thought, holy shit, you're right. You know, his hair looked different. I mean, that's easy to change, but his facial expressions looked different, and the media representation of him was showing some really bizarre facial expressions at times. But he was carrying himself in a whole different way. His deportment was one of leadership, of presence, of authority. And I think the more that we observe what's going on, particularly in the media and on social media, is that there's so much disinformation out there to try to influence people's view, perspective on things. And that this man has been elected. I've seen other posts that say it's for a higher purpose. His role as executioner of the old paradigm, of the old cabal-driven system, even one that said he was a reincarnation of Saint Germain. And I'm really, let's say I'm observing with detachment and with interest to see how this unfolds. I do believe that Hillary would have taken us down a disastrous route. I didn't like a lot of the stuff I saw in the media about Trump, but I have to trust in a higher purpose, and I have to trust that this is for the highest benefit of everybody. And I also believe that this election has been absolutely instrumental in this whole ascension process that we're going through, in terms of A, really bringing to the surface so much stuff that has to be healed in people, in individuals, core issues and so on. And really also making a choice between getting into the fear, the hate, the anger, all those negative egoic emotions around this, or choosing the higher self response of trusting in the higher power, really living that spiritual approach of forgiveness and love and compassion and all these other higher emotions, that without which you are locking yourself into 3D. And I've actually felt that, and I've been a little more vocal on Facebook, that what I teach in my coaching and mentoring practice about neutrality and mindfulness needs to be heard about what choice are you actually making here. If you're choosing division, if you're choosing fear, oh my God, you know, Trump's in, that's it, we're finished. If you're choosing hate, you know, this is actually self-destructive. It's locking you into 3D. If we want to ascend, we have to get into a 5D vibration, into a 5D thinking, into a 5D feeling. And I've actually been quite surprised at some of the reactions in that spiritual conscious community, even from people who are fairly big names in that arena, in terms of how they've reacted to the results of the election.
I thank you so much, because you're seeing it just the way I am. Last night we had a conversation with somebody who had been so against Trump from the beginning that it was like palatable. You know, I mean, she would get physically ill if you even mentioned his name. And even though I had talked to her, just like you're saying, you know, let's just, there apparently is a timeline change. This is not the same man. Give him, you know, support. Think positively towards him. We're not following him. We're using him to make the changes that we need to make, blah, blah, blah. And she was back in the fear mode. You know, to the point of, you know, she is Jewish, and we talked to her about, well, where's this fear coming from? And she went back to the concept of how she was brought up, and she's my age, you know, 65-ish and in the 60s someplace, and back to being brought up in a Jewish environment where the Holocaust was always sort of like right there in your face. And, you know, I mean, at one time she said, yeah, well, you're going to see the trains, you know? And I'm going like, no, I don't think so. But what she couldn't get was, I was not for him. I was not for the person that campaigned at all. But when I saw him, when he walked from behind the curtain and it was this different man, it was like I knew that this is not the same man. This is a timeline change. And that we really should support him because, like you're saying, this is part of the ascension, part of the evolvement of humanity. She could not understand how I had already seen for decades the growing octopus kind of control of Nazi philosophy through the United States, to the point that I was in more peril with a Hillary Clinton there than I am with a Donald Trump who's evolved. He was an evolved being, not the one that was the campaigner. She just negated all of everything that she's ever heard me say about conspiracy stuff because it didn't fit her fear package. What I'm trying to say is that there's an awful lot of people out there that are being drawn back to fears that are coming from childhood. Fears of this and fears of that. But the more we got into it, the real fears are the same fears that everybody else has. The fear of the unknown, the fear of scarcity, the fear of hate, the fear of bigotry, the fear of you know, narcissistic people trying to rule your life. All of these things that are very basic and human. So you've got these stories that give people permission to have fears, but when they address people of the metaphysical or the conspiracy or the truth agenda, we want the truth, they really do not understand the things that we understand. It's much like the horse with the water. They don't understand it. So they're afraid of it. They're actually afraid of what we've been trying to tell them. And so instead of, you know, starting to listen to us, they go even deeper in fear. And I was up in New York, and my family was there, and they were all Hillary people. And, you know, I said to them, they started ranting about Trump. I said, look, there's not much you can do about it now. He's going to be president of the United States, so why don't you pray for him? Because they understand prayer. And they kind of looked at me a little odd, and then they went, okay, you know. But the subject changed. It didn't go down that ranting, anti-Trump thing. But then a few days later, I talked to her on the phone, and she's saying that she's very much afraid because since Trump was elected, she's got friends that, you know, are getting terrible things put on in their mailboxes because one of them is Latino and one of them is black. And that there's more hate crime happening. And it's like when I first noted, well, when I first became aware of the timeline shift, was the timeline shift. I was live on radio. And I suddenly was very preoccupied with something, time, what timeline. We just had a shift. I didn't think of it as we have had a shift. I thought of it as we can make a shift. And everybody, you know, the media and everybody else sort of points at 8 o'clock when I started this discussion about timeline change, that's when it was all happening. And then hearing Starfire Tour, where they were working towards that, actually, you know, using what she calls psi energy to be able to make a change on a timeline, it all made me go and look at the images of Donald Trump. And when I did, because I remembered him with this red hair that doesn't look like much of a hair thing. It looked more like a thing that was on his head. You know, I mean, he really looked ridiculous. And so I go to the pictures, and you see, you know, two-thirds of the pictures were of this redheaded, just as I remembered him. And but there were a few with white, you know, of course, some of the pictures were the pictures that we'd seen that, you know, during that speech when he walks out and he looks so different. And there was a few other ones with, like, gray hair. I mean, it wasn't, but two-thirds of them were all red. So I left the link up, and then when I was shutting down, I was shutting down the links, and I saw it again, only this time, almost all of the photographs were with white hair and gray hair. And that's the Mandela effect. Now, this was one of the clearer indicators of how to address the Mandela effect, because what's happening is you got two timelines, the campaigner and the president-elect. And so now these two timelines are actually vying for our energy. Who's gonna put enough energy in to keep the one dominant? Okay, think in terms of dominant one, you know? And it was obvious to me that the dominant one at that moment was the one where he's an ascended being, not ascended being, but he's different. He's different from the campaigner. This guy looks different, he acts different, he talks different. Okay? So obviously that was where the energy was. Well, after hearing all this stuff about fear and shit, last night I said, well, I'm just going to check. And I go back over to the pictures, and don't you know the red is starting to come back again? It wasn't all white and gray. It's now starting, the old pictures are starting to come back. So what I see happening is I really do see this concept of two timelines. And right now, we've got an awful lot of people out there that are very afraid, that are putting out a tremendous amount of energy directed towards what they consider Donald Trump, which is the campaigner. And so because they're putting their focus on him, they're actually drawing us back into that old timeline.
Yeah. Interestingly, a few days after I looked at the Starfire Tour stuff that was on the Cosmic Reality group, and I actually read the whole, well, I won't say the whole site, but I delved into it. I also was directed to a YouTube video about how to shift timelines. And I thought, that's very interesting because, you know, with the Starfire Tour being all about timelines, and then getting this video about how you can create your own timeline shift into the paradigm that you want, I thought, this is underscoring that there's a lot to this. And I think also, I really feel it's important for us to understand this, not to be challenging these people on their fear, but to give them a way of releasing themselves from it. And I don't know if I'm using the right words here, but
giving them an alternate way of going.
Yeah, yeah. Because one of the things that I was prompted to do, I've been a great fan of the I Ching for quite some years now. And I've actually got an app on my Kindle that I actually do an I Ching oracle reading every day. And it is so much about not getting into ego, not getting into judgment, and the readings were so appropriate for the circumstances that we're seeing at the moment in this really extreme, and I call it hysteria because there's no other word for it. In some cases, it's absolutely hysteria. So I started posting an I Ching reading each day that was so importantly related to our choices of how to respond to this. And so it's as our author, she actually prefixes all her articles with, do not post anything political, do not post any opinions, this is all about truth, this is about getting to the truth. And people are being presented with the biggest opportunity to get into their truth. Is your truth about still being locked into that egoic reaction, that disempowered reaction of the victim of fear and anger and hate? Or are you going to step up and actually step back and ask yourself, what is this triggering in me? Why is it triggering? Is it serving me to allow myself to be triggered in this way? How is that going to resolve the situation? How is that going to create the outcome that I want? What do I need to change in the way I respond to this to actually move in the direction that I want to move in? And, you know, I hate to go, I don't want to raise the horse thing again, but that's exactly what the horses taught me. When you're on a horse that's about to explode underneath you, if you go into fear, if you react in focusing on the problem, not the solution, you pretty damn soon end up flat on the ground and in the worst case scenario, in seriously injured, but that's of your own making because of how you reacted. If you step into your power and you focus on the outcome that you want, you focus on how you can mindfully respond to situations, how you can contribute to the manifestation through the collective consciousness of the paradigm that we want to be living in, instead of getting stuck in what we don't want, then, you know, this is the choice that we're all being asked to make at this time.
Couldn't agree with you more. Now, how do we address these? See, my friend was, you know, I actually said it a couple times yesterday. I said, look it, before you can heal a boil, it has to come to a head. And these concepts of bigotry and of, you know, the putting up walls and fear and all of this sort of thing, they were always there. The fact that the election shows that there is a great deal of despair amongst the white population can be absolutely understood from the concept of, in many ways, they see the ethnic community to be eroding their own lifestyle. The jobs are gone. The schools, you know, are preferential towards others than the whites, in the whites' minds. And that this was a breeding ground of real discontent and probably hate. And so now because of what the campaigner said, everybody's focused on it. Well, he's a racist. Is he? You know, if you start to look at what was actually said, not what the soundbite said, you get a different perspective on the man. Is he a narcissist? Well, a narcissist is somebody that thinks that they're better than anybody else. Donald Trump was raised with Norman Vincent Peale as his minister. And Norman Vincent Peale, you would know him from The Power of Positive Thinking. And one of his main laws is that you picture where you want to be, what you want to do. And no matter what life throws at you, just keep that picture. And it will lead you to success. You will eventually get to that picture. Reality is what we think it is. So is it narcissism, or is it the fact that he understands positive thinking? Because both of them would look the same to us. You know, no, he's got an image in his head, and he's saying, it's okay, everything is fine, don't worry about it, you know, we're going to go there. And in fact, he demolished the Republican Party and then demolished the Democratic Party. And he paid for it with his own money. Probably the only person, or the only type of person that could have done what he did is somebody that's a billionaire. So what do we do, or how do we address, or because you are an amazing health coach that makes people understand their own powers. What kind of message can we give to people that are still in that fear mode? And, you know, you can't underestimate it. I don't underestimate it. Plus the fact that I think they're also being mucked with EMF. An EMF signal, like a Wi-Fi signal, can carry an emotional signal. An emotion is a frequency. They can put hate on you, and you're feeling hate, and you don't even know where it's coming from. It's coming from the Wi-Fi. That's why I'm one of these, you know, my mission is to get Shungai to the masses. But regardless of that, wherever these thoughts are coming from, what can we tell people? How can we give them anything to kind of mitigate the outside influences that they're being subjected to? Because they're seeing the people in the streets scared, and, you know. Although I got to tell the audience, I did see Craigslist, and it had a posting, and it said, if you want to become a protester, we'll pay you $15 an hour. Now, was that put in by somebody who was just making it look like that, or was it real? I don't know. I can't determine that. But I actually saw a Craigslist that said that. So, you got any ideas, Jan?
Yeah.
Good.
Well, first of all, I actually posted on Cosmic Realities Group the latest article from Starfire 4, which is to do with Soros's involvement in these protests. So that's worth looking at Cosmic Reality Group to read that, and how he's played a role in all of this. And, you know, if you look, I always like to go to the source. I don't like to deal with the symptoms. And what we're seeing here in the reaction to this election, and I mean that on both sides. You know, on the one side, you've got the reaction of the Hillary supporters that are devastated by the loss of Hillary's campaign. On the other hand, you know, I've seen some very extreme behavior by people on the so-called winning side. And in fact, you know, this is before the election, there was a video on YouTube by somebody who is, I can't remember, I can't remember his name, anyway. But he's been putting this in the context of the restoration of the Republic. And he was basically talking about the WikiLeaks, actually not the WikiLeaks, it was to do with the exposure of the Wiener emails, and the issues around the paedophilia and so on, and the connections with Epstein and the Lolita Express and everything to do with that. And I actually posted a comment that said, but I've seen Trump being accused of unlawful sex with a 13-year-old at Epstein's, on Epstein's Island. And it was a question, isn't this also something that needs to be looked into? And the response was so vitriolic, and it was, you're an idiot, you're an absolute idiot, this is rubbish, it's been disproved, it's proved. So I came out and said, look, I'm Donald Trump supporter, all I want to know is the truth of this. Can you post me the information that says that this case was thrown out? And I got this response that said, oh, sorry for the insult, here's the link. And I think the role that we have is by disengaging from this conflict situation, for one thing, and being instrumental in the bringing the truth to the surface rather than the propaganda and the manipulated messages that are coming out. The other thing we have to be aware of is that the agenda of the current paradigm is to stimulate the ego to the nth degree through fear. So people have had their ego brought into absolute power, and they are ruled by the ego, which is completely fear-based. So it's no surprise, really, that those who don't understand the ego and who have worked with great diligence to move into a different mindset, that they should have been absolutely stimulated by everything that's happened over the last, what, 18 months. So in my view, what we have to do is we have to go beneath the current situation. If we try and challenge people at the symptom level, which is challenging their belief in their chosen representative, their chosen presidential candidate, all we're going to do is push back. What we have to do is present the underlying alternative. What does it feel like to be in fear? What does it feel like to be angry? What does it feel like to carry hatred in your heart? Does that feel good? Is that actually going to bring you the kind of world that you want to live in? What are the alternatives to that? You know, what if you could shift that feeling even into neutral? You know, I talk a lot about the power of neutrality, how nothing, everything in the universe is meaningless until we assign an interpretation to it. And we can either choose to assign a negative interpretation or a positive or even a neutral. Well, it's really irrelevant. It's so trivial, it doesn't matter. But if we can teach people that they have the power of choice and they have the power of choosing something that will serve them rather than something that will destroy them from within, without reference to the things that are their trigger point, I really believe that's the way to do it. Really at the causal level, at the deep level, at the inner level, rather than at the symptomatic external level. Does that make sense?
It does make sense, but the problem that I have with it, okay, is that the only way I see, what my problem is that the only way that I know how to explain that deeper meaning, that deeper level, is by saying, well, but you're all screwed up to begin with. You're being manipulated to begin with. The banks are, you know, are fantasies. There's all sorts of evil that's out there. These people have been, you know, involved with some very evil act. You know, you got to go to the conspiracy thing to explain it was wrong to begin with. It's broken. And yet they won't believe you because they've never believed you. They've never gotten that far. So what's the other alternative explanation that can draw them in without drawing them into confronting, you know, what is it that they call it? Disturbing facts, you know?
It's cognitive dissonance.
Right.
Yeah. And I think that's through, it is a very fine line to tread, and I'm not saying it's easy by any means. It, you know, the way I explain manifestation is, you know, a lot of people in that kind of law of attraction community are very into all positive thinking, ignore the problems, ignore all of that negative stuff. What I believe is that you can have an awareness of a problem without feeding it energy. You kind of literally hold it at the back of your mind. So I'm aware that this is a problem, but I'm going to put all my focus on the outcome. And what I feel is the way to address this is we know all the stuff that's what they call the conspiracy theory, which we know as conspiracy fact. But we don't have to focus on what's wrong in order to lead them into something that's right. I mean, I'm not a Christian in the religious sense of the word, but, you know, Jesus's preachings, he didn't go and attack everything that was wrong. Yeah, he might have thrown the money changers out of the temple, but he was leading people into what was right. So if we can present people with alternatives that they see as being solutions to the problem, while not challenging their belief system that just brings immediate resistance, that to me is the way to go forward. Look at it this way, you know? How about looking at it this way? You know, people that promote solar energy don't do it by attacking conventional sources as, oh, this is so terrible, you've got to stop driving your car and da da da. What they do is they present an alternative that says, how about using this for your house? This could bring you all these benefits. And so there is a way.
Would that way be talking in terms of energy, of positive thinking, of praying? Why don't you follow Christ? You know, can you give me some kind of solid ways that you would address it?
I think it's you know, positive thinking is in many cases unfocused. I think it's really about outcome thinking rather than problem thinking. And yes, in some cases, it's, you know, it can be praying, it can be asking for guidance, but a lot of the people that we're talking about here aren't spiritually connected. And the other thing is to remember, of course, Nancy, is that we're dealing with, I always like to step back in this and say, okay, we need to look at this from the helicopter view. We're all on this earth plane for a reason. We're all living out our own purpose. We are all actually in this major role play. And it's very interesting. I had an exchange on Facebook the other day with somebody who's a connection who I've never met, lives in Oklahoma, thinks the sun shines out of Bill and I for some reason. And he put a post up and said he was feeling really weird, in his words, because a family member had died. And this particular family member had caused all sorts of problems in the family, had been really obnoxious, horrible, and even he used the word evil. But yet he still feels saddened by it. And he couldn't understand why he was feeling the way he was. So I put a response up that said, Steve, you feel this way because you're love at the core. And how wonderful for that family member to have played a role to enable you to discover that. And he was blown away by this and said he'd shared it with all his family members to help them come to terms with the death of this person who had, in his words, had really been quite evil. And it brought back to me a conversation I'd had with a guest on our radio show that referred to the book by Neil Donald Walsh called The Little Soul and the Sun. And it was all to do with this role play that we come into this incarnation to fulfill. And the conversation was, this little soul was saying, I'd really like to learn forgiveness. And the other soul that was going to do the role play, who was making a soul contract, said, well, what I'd really like is for you to remember that when I do all these really awful things to you, you remember that I actually love you and I'm only doing this to help you. And this prompted me to put up this meme on Facebook saying, how can we learn forgiveness if we've got nothing to forgive? And what I'm trying to do is to get people to raise their view, to see this in a much bigger context of what this paradigm is all about, that we have the choice to move into that loving, forgiving, beautiful, higher self of neutrality, of non-judgment, of all, and all of that. And we also have the choice to get stuck in that egoic, fearful, hating, victim, angry, you know, the rest, all the negative. But some people aren't ready yet. We're all at different stages of evolution. So to actually expect to be able to turn a huge proportion of the current humanity on this planet around into a different paradigm, it's probably actually not in alignment with their level of evolution at this point. So it's really about sowing the seeds for those people that are ready to be open to a different paradigm, to a different perspective, and accept the greatest respect we can give to people is to respect where they are on their path. It's not our job to do an evangelical, let's convert everybody. It's about the bridge from where they are to where we can lead them. It's opening up the possibility of a different perspective. And some people are just not going to be open to that, and we need to accept that. But for those people that do want something different, who are ready to awaken, we can offer them a helping hand across that bridge.
I think you just did give a lot of people a helping hand across that bridge. I just so appreciate and respect what you do, Jan. One of my favorite people. Please tell that your website, so that people and the services that you actually have on the site.
Okay. The website to go to is asmilingworld.org. Our vision is to create a smiling world, and my role is as a spiritual empowerment and intuitive success coach, and actually helping people to really address the fear issues, the things that are holding them back, getting over that not good enough perception of themselves and really becoming unstoppable. So if you go to smilingworld.org, you can get a free copy of the Dream Achiever Success Kit, and that's what I'm all about. It's helping people to step into their fullest power, live their truth, and achieve their dreams.
Well, I like I say, You've helped me get to an understanding of it, and I hope other people have too, of how we can help everybody without getting them pissed off at us.
You know, thank like you.
Very key to life, you know. Don't get anybody pissed off at you. I thank you so much for being here. Like I say, give a hug to Bill. Bill is her husband, by the way.
Yes, I will.
Awesome man. And, you know, hugs the puppies for me.
Will do. And I've so enjoyed having the opportunity to horse talk with Emily as well. That's
well, you know, good. I wasn't really sure about how the chat would, you know, but I went over at the break and I looked at the chat and they were very engaged in it. So, yeah, good. I think that everybody learns, because I did. I was sitting here going like, well, this isn't much different than just dealing with people, you know, human beings. And in a very basic way, you know, it was like, yeah, yeah, yeah. And it was fascinating.
I have to say, Nancy, I was going to say, you know, that horse, that Andalusian called Voto, his name was Devoto. He taught me so much about how to help the people that I work with in my coaching and mentoring practice, how to overcome fear, how to manifest through visualization. I mean, the principles that these animals can teach us are so profound as when you're tuned into them. So much of what I learned through my experience with horses, I pass on to my clients, and it's just been such a gift. I cannot put into words how influential they've been in my life.
It's very inspiring. I thank you so much for sharing. Emily, you're going to be up next. Your show, you know what you're going to be talking about? You want to?
Yeah, I'm actually going to be continuing from last week with Irish folklore. Oh, cool. And I had a request from the chat to do a segment on what I learned from my horses this week, so we're going to add that in.
Oh, excellent. Colleen, you've got Emily coming up, so Jan and I will fade off into the woodwork or whatever it does.
To the sunset. To the sunset.
We hang up from
the ether. To the ether.
Into the ethers, yes. Let's go ether hopping here. Thanks, everybody, for listening to us. You've been listening to the Say What Show with Jan Moore as our guest, and Emily Norcross as our co-host, and Colleen Kelly and myself. And just have a great week. Tomorrow I will be on Simon Says. Simon Parks has got a show that starts at 2 Eastern time, and then Walt and I will talk about what Simon Says. It's the easiest show we do because we just, you know, what did he say? What does that mean? I have to take notes, though. But we'll be there at 4 o'clock. So appreciate everybody. Be safe, and see you next time. Thanks.
You've been listening to Say What on Haggy Shack Radio at HaggyShack.com. Simulcast to Wolf Spirit Radio.